Jesus.
Hallelujah.
We honor you this day. We ask that you be glorified. Let your name be lifted up here. Speak to us in the language that we will understand. Minister life to the hearer and life to the speaker. In Jesus' precious name we pray. And everybody say a big amen.
Amen.
Look at your neighbor, say, I'm glad to see you in church. Hallelujah. Eschatology. Can we all say it together?
Eschatology.
It means the end times. And we have been studying on the end times, started last Sunday. How many people were blessed last Sunday? Amen. Look at your neighbor and say, I won't be here. When there will be breaking news. On CNN, on Sky, and BBC. I will be looking from heaven. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
I don't know about you, but I don't plan to be here when that breaking news will happen. Because the Bible says all eyes shall see him. Like I told you last Sunday, it's going to happen in such a way that I gave you the timeline for the rapture. And I told you that about the rapture, that's the next day the church is expecting. And I told you about the manifestation of the Antichrist. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Once the rapture takes place, everything is going to happen in very fast succession. Because between the rapture and the second appearing of Jesus Christ, which is going to happen in Israel, will be 7 years. So things are going to happen very fast. Amen. Between the rapture and the appearing of Jesus physically, when all eyes shall see him, will be 7 years. So immediately the rapture takes place, there's going to be commotion all over the world, all over. BBC will be carrying news, breaking news, millions of people disappear. CNN will be carrying it. Antichrist would have been on earth by then. He will become a political power. Everybody will be looking for who to help them. And one man will appear, and I'm going to tell you how that is going to happen in a minute. And he will be elected as the president of the world. As the president of maybe the United Nations, depending on what they decide to call it at that time. And Satan will enter into that man. You remember our illustration?
Yes, sir.
And I told you that that is why his name is called the Antichrist, as the Americans would say. In Britain, we say the Antichrist. Amen.
Amen.
Satan will walk into him and possess him. His actions and behavior will be direct orders from Lucifer himself, not from demons, not from principalities, not from witches, direct from Lucifer. He will be so powerful, he will possess miraculous powers to the extent that we are told that the most powerful religious leader of that time will submit to him and be his prophet. Who the world, a lot of preachers believe to be the Pope. We agree that this man is of God. He will be so powerful, both militarily and religiously, that people will revere him almost as Christ. Israel will think that this is the man they have been waiting for, because Israel rejected the first Christ. They will think this is the man they've been waiting for, and because of that, they will agree for him to sign an agreement of 7 years of peace between Israel and the Arab nations. They will agree, they will sign it. And that peace agreement is already being put in place right now. And in the 3.5 years of that peace being signed, he will manifest something, he will do something that will make Israel know that, this is not our practice, this is not the man we've been waiting for. And Israel will rebel against him. And the Bible says, after the 3.5 years, he will break the covenant with Israel. He will enter into the temple and make sacrifices that are not acceptable to Israelites. And then they will reject him. At that point, he himself and Israel will become against each other. And he will declare to the whole world, like Hitler did some years back, that Israel is the problem of the world. that the only way for there to be world peace is for Israel to be eliminated. At that point, he will mobilize army, soldiers all over the world to fight Israel. And he will gather them in a place called what? Armageddon. You were here last Sunday. Amen.
Amen.
The name of that place is called Armageddon. And that is what we all popularly refer to as the battle of Armageddon. The intention is to wipe out Israel. Military power, the strongest in the world, to wipe out Israel. Israel will be so small. Right now, Israel is smaller than any of the Arab nations. Any, when you pick one Arab nation, Israel, just one. Israel is smaller than that. So you can imagine the whole Arab countries, you can imagine the whole Europe, you can imagine the military powers that be with their nuclear weapons surrounding Israel. Israel will know that this is the end. While Israelites are about to pray their last prayer, ready for to accept their fate, whatever is going to happen to them, the Bible says, don't forget that that period, armies have gathered, things have happened, CNN is recording what is going on. Right now, they are totally against Christianity and against Israel and against so many things. BBC, their satellites are beamed, Sky, their satellites are beamed all on Israel. Because all attention is now here in Israel. So all the satellites, major television networks worldwide are beamed on Israel, reporting live what is happening, breaking news every day. And then when the order is about to be given for the army to strike against Israel, suddenly the clouds will change. The Bible says the moon will turn red and the sun will become black. Everywhere will suddenly become dark, deep darkness. And then suddenly, the light of the Son of God will appear in the skies. And that is how, when the Bible says, all eyes shall see him, both those in the villages, those in the cities, all over the world, watching life events happening in Israel, will watch as the Son of God, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, descends and lands on the same mountain that he took off in Israel. Somebody say a big amen.
Amen.
He will come with thousands of angels. He will come with thousands of the saints that have been raptured. You and I will be there.
Amen.
Somebody say a big amen.
Amen.
So, the television networks are reporting. Everybody is reporting what is going on. And they all see it. So Bible is fulfilled. So you can see very easily how the scripture is going to be fulfilled. Today, we are moving forward from there. And our topic for today is signs of the end. How do we know that we are actually in the end times? How do we know? I'm going to do a little bit of summary of that to be able to assist you on that. And I'm going to read a few scriptures before we go into details. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 1 to 9. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and by our gathering together unto him, that you be not soon shaken in your mind or be troubled, neither by spirit nor by word, nor by letter as of us, as that day of Christ is at hand. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there be a falling away first, and that man of sin is revealed, the man of perdition, who opposes and exalteth himself above all that is called God, that is the Antichrist, all that is worshipped, so that he as God seated in the temple, showing himself that he is God. Remember ye that when I was with you, I told you these things. And now you know what we told them that he might be revealed. For the mystery of iniquity, take note of this scripture, very important, very key scripture. Can we all read verse 7 together if you are there? Because this is very, very important. Everybody want to go? God already walk. Only him who not letteth will let until he be what? Taken out of the way. The mystery of iniquity. is already working. In other words, things are already in place for the manifestation of the Antichrist. That's what Paul is saying. And when you see these things begin to happen, he said, know that the mystery of iniquity has already been established. The foundation for the Antichrist to be manifest is already there. But there is only one reason why it's not yet being made manifest, because the Holy Ghost is still on earth. Two powers cannot dwell in the same place at the same time. Don't forget, this is Lucifer coming himself. This is not demons. Right now, demons are operating. Lucifer has not appeared to him. Anybody that tells you Lucifer appeared to him is lying. Lucifer has been bound somewhere. It is the demons that are operating. If Lucifer appeared to you, who survived it? Even if angels come to your attention. You understand what I'm saying? If you know who Lucifer is, you understand why you can't survive it. God has not allowed him yet. It's not yet his time. His demons are operating. When Moses died, Lucifer contended for his body. Even the angel that went there could not contend with him. That's how powerful Lucifer is. Don't forget he was their boss. Amen? When we look at the man in the Bible called the Joshua, when he was 30, the angel came. The angel couldn't do anything. The angel only said the Lord revealed him. The angel could not fight him. When you see manifestations of Lucifer himself in the Bible, you describe that even angels tremble when they see him. Because Lucifer was once their boss. Lucifer was what in Nigeria you call the Oga Kwata-Kwata. One man will call him the general overseer of them all. That was Lucifer. If Lucifer appears, sometimes Lucifer has the capacity to take upon him the image of Christ. The Bible says sometimes he looks like the bright and morning star. He shines when he appears. Sometimes you might not, because God did not take his glory from him when he fell. But that's another topic for another day. Lucifer is powerful. He was the commander of the heavenly forces. He was so powerful that he was next to God. After the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, the next person was Lucifer. The angels referred him. He was so powerful that he was able to tell himself that he can see from the throne of God. Now that's Lucifer. That was Lucifer. He was so powerful that when he fell, the Bible says he was able to convince one third of the angels to fall with him. That is Lucifer. Yeah. He was so powerful that when he fell, the Bible recorded in Isaiah and Ezekiel that the mountains trembled at his appearance. He was so powerful that when he fell, Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 said the earth was tohu bavohu without form and form. That was Lucifer. When he landed on the earth, because the Bible said that God sent him away, threw him down to the earth. When he landed, the earth broke into two. There was trouble, there was commotion, there was what you call, floods everywhere. Things that existed went into vanished because Lucifer came down in anger. That same Lucifer will enter one man. And he will be called the Antichrist. He will be the opposite of Christ. Everything Christ represented, he will represent, but he will be the opposite. So, but what is stopping him? That's why I'm going into length to express Lucifer. Because some people see demons, they thought they saw Lucifer. If Lucifer appeared to your flesh, you can't survive him. The guy is too powerful. The guy is too powerful. God had to anoint another angel, Angel Michael, in his place, that was able to gather other angels to defeat him and chase him away. That is how powerful Lucifer is. And when he was chased away, he was locked up, and there are scriptures that show that he was chained. And there are also angels that are chained. Two angels or four angels chained in the four corners of the world. Because those ones were so angry one time that when men sinned against God, they wanted to wipe out the world. God said they should chain them because they were too angry. They wanted to fight on behalf of God. And these are spiritual things you need to understand. Go and read the book of Revelations. Your eyes will open. Somebody say big amen. Now, but why did I say we should all read that scripture? He said, he elected will continue to let until he be taken out of the way. So the rapture is the taking away of the Holy Spirit. It is the end of the dispensation of the Holy Spirit, the three person, the third person in the Trinity. Is the reason why Lucifer cannot appear physically. He that let it will continue to stop him He that stoppeth him will continue to stop him until it is taken out of the way. When he's taken out of the way, Lucifer will have free reign on the earth. He will come in and he will do terrible things that the Bible says nothing like that has ever been done since the beginning of the world. It's going to be a terrible time. And like I told you last Sunday, a lot of people don't forget, some Christians will need the rapture. Say, not me.
Not me.
Say it one more time. Say, not me.
Not me.
But when we are saying not me, the truth is some Christians will need the rapture. I mean, some church-going Christians. And they have heard about the rapture as I'm talking now. They have heard about it. Don't forget that Jesus said the days of his coming will be like the days of Noah. Noah kept warning about the flood. People had, but they refused to enter the ark. They had. So a lot of people will hear about the rapture, but they won't believe it until when it happens. When the news goes round and everybody has heard about it, those people will become very serious. They'll say, this thing Pastor John talked about has happened. This thing Pastor Matthew talked about has happened. This thing Kumu you spoke about has happened. This thing pastors have been shouting has happened. They will become very serious with God. It is those Christians that will need the Antichrist. The second group of Christians are those who were unbelievers, atheists, who never believed in God. When they heard what is happening and their parents have taught them, they have read it in scripture, or somebody has whispered it to them one time or the other, they will repent and give their life to Christ. But then the Holy Spirit has been taken away. The blood of Jesus is no longer effective for them. They will pay for their salvation with their own blood. That's what the Antichrist is going to do. The Antichrist is going to slaughter Christians. He's going to say both Israelites and the Christians are the trouble. They are the one causing problem. Let's wipe them away. So there's going to be bloodbaths. There's going to be bloodletting. They're going to all these things you see ISIS doing now will be a child's play compared to what's going to happen. Somebody say big amen. Now he said, for the mystery of iniquity. It's already working, but he that letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. Verse 8, and then, somebody say, and then shall the wicked one be revealed. Whom the Lord shall consume with the spirit of his mouth, that is when he descends, and shall destroy from the brightness of his coming. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan. Did you hear that? Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan, with all power and signs and lying wonders. It's going to be so powerful, so powerful. If you go into a detailed description of Antichrist, the Bible even mentioned that he will have power to pour fire down from heaven. He's so powerful. So powerful that even religious leaders will think he's the real one, he's the real deal. Now let's go to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13 to 18. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, 1 Thessalonians 4, 13, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds, so to meet the Lord in the air, to meet the Lord in the air. This is the rapture. Jesus is not coming. His foot is not stepping on the earth at that time. We are going to meet him where? In the air. To meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we be with the Lord. Therefore, comfort one another with this word. Your uncle, your house, your uncle, your dad, your mom that died, you are going to see them very soon. If they died in the Lord. Somebody say big amen.
Amen.
If they died in the Lord, the Bible says, don't be discouraged. You are going to meet them. Matthew 24. I told you we are going to read a few scriptures before we go into what we have for today. Matthew 24. If you are there, let's go to Matthew 24. My God, today is going to be hot. Matthew 24. And Jesus, from verse 1, when Jesus went out and departed from the temple, And his disciples came to him for to show him the building of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, do you see these things? Verily I say to you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. Jesus came out of the temple. The disciples were so, you know, proud. They said, Master, can you imagine the beautiful edifice? This is the temple of Solomon. The second temple of Solomon was so beautiful. And Jesus said to them, let me tell you the beginning of things that will happen. Not one stone will be left upon this building that you are seeing. And we are told that that prophecy came to pass in 70 AD when the emperor called Nero invaded Jerusalem and brought down the temple, slaughtered the Jews in so much so that the Bible, the story, the historians, like when you read Ephesus and some other historians, they said that blood was flowing from the temple like water on the stairs of the temple. Because the reason was because a lot of Jewish zealots entered into the temple to defend it. It was their last defense. They said, we'd rather die than see the temple being destroyed. So a lot of priests, a lot of Jews entered the temple to say, look, you even need to bring down the Holy Israel, you can't bring down the temple. And because of the hundreds of thousands of people that went to defend the temple, the Roman emperor slaughtered so much people that blood was flowing like a pond. It was terrible. But that was the fulfillment of the prophecy. That was when Israel was scattered completely all over the world. Israel was scattered completely. But Jesus prophesied that they will come back together again. And he said the generation that we see Israel come back together as a nation, that generation is the beginning that we see the end of the world. Somebody say big amen. Amen. Now in verse 2 he said, and Jesus said to them, do you see the things? There shall not be left here one stone upon another. And verse 3, and as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, which is the same mountain upon which he ascended and he will come back, the disciples came unto him privately and said, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the signs of thy coming and the end of the world? And Jesus said unto them, take heed that no man deceive you. For many shall come in my name, saying, I am Christ, and shall deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars, and you shall be troubled. See that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation shall rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom, and there shall be famines and pestilence and earthquakes in diverse places. All these are the beginning of sorrows. Then shall they deliver you up to be afflicted, and shall kill you, and shall be hated of all nations for my name's sake. And then shall many be offended, and shall betray one another, and hate one another. And many false prophets shall rise, and shall deceive many. And because, verse number 12, can we all read it together? Everybody want to go? The love of many shall wax old. Now let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 4. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm going to Matthew 24 is an assignment. If you go get home, please read Matthew 24 from beginning to the end. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 4 started with this. Look at this. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter days some shall do what? Depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of the devil, starting from where Jesus just said, that because iniquity will abound, the love of many what? Wax cold. A lot of people, in other words, one of the major signs of the end times is backsliding Christianity. A lot of people are going to give up on their faith. Now, before we go into that, let's go to 2 Timothy chapter 3. 2 Timothy chapter 3. And let's see what the scripture says there as well. And that will be the last scripture I'll read before we start the main thing. This know that in the last days, perilous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, holy, without natural affection, gays and lesbians, truth breakers. They don't have natural affection. Take note of scriptures, so don't say you were not told. having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof. That is verse number 5. Somebody say a big amen. Now let's look at some things, because I can go on and on and on and on and on to this scripture that have to do with the end times. But let's look at a few things. Now, number one sign, I'm going to just give you 10 signs of the end time as we go ahead. Number one, like we said, is that iniquity shall abound. Iniquity shall abound. Sin will become common. And sin will become something that is no longer worried the heart of people. It will now become, you know, the other day we were, yesterday, I was watching the television, and in France, a young man's head was cut off. I don't know how many of you heard the news. All right, a teacher who was showing some things to students, his head was cut off. And then before now, when you hear that somebody's head was cut off, it's an outrage, but now it's like, it's the news now. When you announce something like that, it's the news. People just, you know, flip over it and go as if nothing has happened. But there was a time when one person being killed was like everybody would be shivering. Are you understand what I'm saying? There was a time when terrorists attacked. It was like, wow, people will even be scared to go to the train station. But now, you will hear that terrorists just attacked one train station. In 1 hour, they cleared it. Everybody is still going back there. Why? Because iniquity has what? Abounded. So there has been desensitization. Amen. People are being desensitized. Things no longer matter to people. I don't want to talk about my own country. In my country where I come from, those days when accident happened, it was an issue. Now, people will go to church, somebody will throw a bomb, there are 200 people there, nobody will announce it. It's like, we are told that Boko Haram in my country is the second most terrible, terrorist organization in the world. Nobody cares, it's like normal thing now. If you hear that people are killed, 500 people slaughtered at once, nobody, newspaper don't bother to hide anymore. Desensitization. Before I came to the United Kingdom, to hear that a man and a woman that is not married are living together was a serious issue. I don't know about you, it was a serious issue. When I came to UK, I discovered that even pastors know about it, but they keep quiet. Everybody has become desensitized. Those things no longer, a man, I love, they'll go home and start living, they'll start having children. I don't know what is going on with this. There is no more, the issue of sensitization about faith no longer matters to people. I don't understand what I'm saying. People not do things that it doesn't, their conscience does not feed them. It doesn't matter, their conscience has died. The devil has seared their conscience with hot iron. When you get to that point where your conscience, you can see, and there are people that lie. And when they lie, even the devil respects them. I don't understand what I'm saying. The devil look at them and said, they say the devil is a liar, but God will lie for them. There are human beings like that. Their conscience are dead. They can lie, and you that is telling the truth will be stoned, because people will believe the lie rather than the truth. Human beings. There are people that when they commit sin, the devil will sit down and be taking notes. I'm telling you, that is how bad human hearts have become. Their hearts have become seared. Christianity is not evil to them because the time is near. When you want to be good, I was as a lawyer, I was talking to a young girl about the immigration system of UK. I said, if BBC invites me one day to talk, I said there will be an earthquake in this country. Because of what I know, there will be an earthquake. UK don't know what is going on. They don't know. If you are a Christian and you walk up to immigration, tell them I'm a Christian. Why did you come here? I came for a better life. Don't tell them the truth. Look, where I'm coming from, things are bad. I am here. I want to make it for my family. They'll send you back. Tell them lies. They'll believe you. I understand what I'm saying. I Simon Peter, she claimed asylum. When she claimed asylum, they interviewed her. They said, come. And they interviewed her. She's from one of these Eastern African countries. And when they were interviewed, where is the railway from? Now, when they interviewed her, she told them about, you know, Morgan Tsvangirai was alive at that time. She said, I'm a member of the MPC. I went for demonstration. The soldiers captured me. They raped me. They beat me. They did this. And she started crying. While she was crying, the white lady that knew her brother, she said, you want a break? She said, yes, I want a break. And they went on break. And after all the break, she came back and started crying again. The woman said, okay, don't cry. I know your story. And they gave her a salon. When she came to me one day, she said, Pastor, everything was a lie.
Wow.
That is the kind of thing they love to believe.
Yeah.
Go and tell them the truth. They won't believe it. The world has become desensitized to truth. The more truthful you are, the more enemy you have for them. But the more you lie, the more they say, hey, yes, it's you we believe. It's you we believe. How can you tell me that a 9-year-old child has the mental capacity to determine his or her sex? 9-year-old! When I was 9, I was still wearing pampers. They should determine whether they are male or they are female. 9 years, take them away from their parents. What a wicked generation. That is the generation we live in. That's the generation we live in. He said, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many will wax cold. The love of many will wax cold. May God deliver us from this ungodly generation.
Amen.
Somebody say a big amen. So, that is the generation we are living in. A generation that is so stubborn to the things of God. He says sin will be everywhere. Do you know these days? Why are they manufacturing security for your children on internet, on laptops and iPad? You try to monitor what your children watch on television. Are you monitoring the one they are showing them on iPad? You put on your iPad adverts, whether you like it or not. You begin to see things that will defy your eye, defy your mind, defy your heart. He said iniquity will abound. Iniquity will abound. No more difference between boy and girl. No more difference. A child will wake up, say, oh, I feel like wearing girl's clothes. They say, I love you. That is the way you was born. May the Lord deliver us in the mighty name of Jesus. He said, iniquity will abound. And because of so much iniquity, he said the love of people for God, for godly things will begin to go forward. Because they are living everywhere you turn around. I am sorry for our children of these days. Children of these days. Because they are growing up in the midst. That's why our children need to be on fire. Because a revival must happen. Our children will have to take it to their schools. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
You have to take it to your place of work. You have to take it to your neighbors. We shouldn't make a generation that is an indomie generation. That don't know how to pray. They don't know how to fast. I was asking one child some time ago in Nigeria. No, it wasn't Nigeria, I think it was in America. And we traveled for it. And I said, do you know about the rapture? He said, is it not that thing where they said? And this is a pastor's child. He said, is it not that stuff where they said Jesus will come and we will? That stuff? We're not taking this thing seriously. That's the generation we are raising. We need to raise a generation on fire for God. A generation that knows their God. That's why don't joke with how you bring up your child. Don't joke with your going to church. Don't joke with your daily communication with God. Don't joke with your family prayer. Because the next generation, the future of the next generation is in your hands. If you don't raise them up well, Islam will take over. Somebody say a big amen.
Amen.
If you don't raise raise the next generation well. Antichrist will overwhelm them before they know it. This will happen. He said iniquity. He said number one sign. Paul mentioned it. Jesus mentioned it. Peter mentioned it. Revelation mentioned it. He said number one sign you will know. He said that generation where iniquity will be so much. Sin will be so much. Fornication will not. When you hear these days that people are dating, you know, in those days when we talk about dating, when we talk about now they call it dating, we call it courtship in our time. When me and my wife were caught, it was prayer time, fasting time, reading the word of God. We were not allowed to even meet in dark places or alone. Church was always involved. If you are going to meet, maybe meet in the church, pray, talk. These days they say dating. What is the definition of dating, bro? Pretend marriage. I like these young modern people. They know the language more than I do. Dating is no longer dating. Is also a time to know each other, pray, talk about your future. You are already doing what you want to do after marriage. Defiling the bed, destroying your future. In the name of dating, fornication is like normal. You hear a 16-year-old child say, "My heart was broken, broken by who?" What a disastrous generation. I was 18, 19, 20. I didn't know what a girl's body looked like. We were serious with our education, serious with our thought. In this generation, 16 years, crying, my, she broke my heart. You need flogging. You know, use pain and I don't need deliverance. Deliverance is breaking your heart at 16. What do you have to do with heartbreaking at 16? What's your problem? What a disastrous generation. He said, iniquity shall abound. And because of that, the love of many will wax old. No wonder he said, them, let us pray, they are not interested. Because the love is not there anymore. The love for the things of God, Satan has wiped it out with sin. No wonder he said, let us go to church, they are dragging their legs, I don't want to go. Because their friends will tell them, me, you are 17, you are 18, and you are still a virgin, they'll be laughing at you. The generation we are living in. May God deliver our generation. He said that's number one sign. And when you see that generation, he said, know that the end is near. The generation that will force condition on their parents. At 11, they are already teaching them police numbers. If your parents smack you, call the police. Iniquity shall happen. May the Lord help us. Number two, how do you know you are at the end time? Falling away from the faith. He said churches will be empty. People will find it difficult to go to church. People will struggle to go to the house of God. The excitement to go to church is no longer there. He said that generation know that Jesus is coming. Number three, rebellion against God, both politically and socially. Rebellion against God. If you apply for a job now, they'll tell you, are you this or that? People from this society are underrepresented. Have you ever seen it in your job employment? We want them to be represented. Rebellion against God. Deliberately going against the law of God. It's a generation. A generation that we say we don't want Christ in our classrooms. Don't tell our children to pray when they come to school. Don't teach them about God. That generation, that is what we are talking about, the signs of the end. Number four, famines, pestilences, and natural disasters. Coronavirus that cannot be treated, that the world finds difficult to handle. Famines, pestilences, and natural disasters. We read about four or five scriptures. So I'm talking, picking from those scriptures. I don't know, because if I pick up a topic and then give you scriptures, we're going to spend another 3-4 hours here. By the way, I need to tell that anything that has to do with the end time needs about at least 6 months to exhaust it. So don't expect to finish everything in just one month. Number five, wars and rumors of wars. There will be war and there will be rumors of war. Signs of the end. And more wars are coming. A lot of wars have been fought. First World War, Second World War, and how many of you know Third World War is on the way? Amen. And the Third World War is going to be a nuclear war. It's going to be a war where Jesus himself will be involved. And it's happening very soon. Somebody say big amen. Amen. Peter was right and he said the earth shall be wiped away with famine. He's talking about nuclear power, nuclear weapons. The end of the world will come by way of fire. That's what Peter saw in his vision. Number six, hatred towards Israel and the church. He said, when you see that generation where they hate Israel so much and they hate the church, anything presenting, he said, no, that the end is near. Number seven, when you see the abomination that make desolate stand in the church, Jesus said it. He said, that generation, Matthew 24 is there. He said, when you see the abomination that make desolate, say, no, that the end is near. And I explained to you, I said, the issue of gays and lesbians was called abomination in the Old Testament. And when you see it happening on the altar of God, where priests are bold enough, a generation for the first time in the history of the world, where people that carry the name of God, carry the altar of God, where colors and crosses, come out and tell you that they are now gay. You say, no, that generation is finished. That is the generation. He's giving you signs. So when you see these signs, no. He said you might not know the day or the hour. You might not know the exact time. But when you see these signs, begin to prepare. Because it's very close. Somebody say big amen. Amen. Number eight, the rise of false prophets and false doctrines. Oh my God. Child of God, be careful who lays hands on you. Be careful. Not everybody that calls themselves pastors now carry godly power. A lot of them go to obtain power from spiritual forces. There are places you go to now. I know of countries where you go to right now, they wash your eyes, you begin to see people's past. Are you understand what I'm saying? I'm telling you things. People go to some satanic altars. They use certain things, sacrifices, wash their eyes. And then they will come and start telling you what you did in the past. 2 years ago, this happened in your house. Your house number is number 23, 45 Avenue. They start telling you your plate number is this, that. Your son's name is starts with J. You have any child called starts with J. He said Junior. Say, yeah, I'm talking about Junior. Prophecies. False prophets. I'm not saying all of them are false. Somebody say amen. Not all prophets are false, but the Bible says that one of the major signs of the end will be the rise of false prophets. Prophets that are prophesying in the name of the devil, but they're in the church. Sheep or wolves in sheep clothing. They'll pretend to be Christians, but they are serving Satan. How do you know them? By their fruits, you shall know them. Watch their lifestyle. Watch the kind of thing they do. Then you know whether they are false or not. So false prophets, false doctrines, telling you to eat grass, you get anointed. Carry snake, one man carry snake, said the same way snake was used in both testaments, the snake bites man, he died inside the church. False prophets, all sorts of things, telling you to do so many things, false doctrines. Somebody said the reason why Jesus not only made disciples was that they were gay. False doctrine, false prophets. Just to justify, I was telling somebody, I said, if a man wants to justify marrying many wives, he will preach Solomon.
Yes.
Which after all, Solomon was in heaven, Abraham married money, so I should have nothing wrong with that. People will always raise things to justify what they preach. False prophets, false doctrine. Number nine. Jerusalem again becoming the capital of Israel. And my God, last year that happened. Wasn't that last year? Jerusalem again becoming the capital of Israel, sign of the end, written in scripture. Say that generation will see the coming of Christ. Somebody say a big amen. The last one, which I am going to emphasize on, the rise of a strong military power in Europe. The rise of a strong military power in Europe. Last one that I told you to watch out for three countries. Which country did I mention? America, China, Russia, and where? Europe. Somebody say Europe. And I told you that according to my own calculation, I discovered that Europe is going to be the epicenter of the end time. And it's going to be the place where the Antichrist is going to come from. Now, when you look at it, to tell you that we're in the end time and things are happening so fast, just nobody dreamt that Trump would be elected president. And many people don't know why he was elected president, but child of God, Trump is fulfilling scriptures. Somebody say a big amen. Trump has done a lot in less than 4 years that has hastened the coming of the Antichrist. That except he loses this election, if Trump wins the next election, you better get ready. Like that pastor said, in 10 years' time, Jesus is coming. In less than 10 years, anything can happen. Because the way Trump is fast-forwarding scripture, he baffles everybody. It's like he was, because nobody expected him to win. And he won. What has he done since he came into power? Let me tell you things that will shock you. Number one, he moved the capital of Israel to Jerusalem, which every American president has promised to do. Everyone, none of them did it. Immediately Trump came into power, like a bulldozer out of nowhere, whatever will happen, let it happen. He moved it, and nothing happened. That was number one. Number two, he started signing peace agreement for the first time in the history of the world between Israel and powerful Arab enemies. Fulfilling prophecy. Number three, which leads us to what we just said. Trump came to the United Nations and made an announcement that shook everybody. He said, from today, America is no longer funding the United Nations and NATO. Now, this is the most powerful announcement ever. More powerful than the moving of the capital to Israel. He said, America has been the policeman of the world. He said, but from now on, all man to themselves. We will only pay what we are due. We won't pay for other people. Now, what is the implication of that statement? In 1999, the European nation met. The European Union met. And they decided that America is gradually leading away from, globalization and protecting the world. And because of that, Europe has to have its own army. I'm coming to that. Follow me. Look at somebody, say, follow him. Amen. Something is happening. Now, this will lead you to something very shocking. Very, very shocking. Now, why will Europe be the epicenter? Because Europe is the emerging superpower. China is having problems. Russia is having its own problem. America's power is declining. And if Trump wins again, America will no longer protect the world. So Europe has no alternative than to have its own army for the first time in the history of the world. Once that happens, the only thing that will be left for Europe will be the election of a leader. Who will be the European Union? And let me show you this. Oh my God, I'm excited. Somebody say the amen. Amen. Let me show you something about the timeline of Europe. And then I'm going to show you the scripture that talks about Europe. The timeline of Europe. Follow me very carefully. This is very, very important. Now, the European, in 1950, Europe was formed. The first six nations that established Europe were Belgium, France, Germany, Italy, Luxembourg, and Netherlands. That was in 1950. The European Parliament first met in Strasbourg on the 19th of March, 1958, at the European Parliament. And in 1962, 30th of March, they met again to officially establish and make it concrete and make it a law. Somebody say big amen. that Denmark, Ireland, and United Kingdom joined the European Union on the 1st of January 1973, raising the number of members to 9. Initially, they were about 5 or 6. Now, in 1981, Greece became the 10th member. Very important. Greece became the 10th member. Now, these 10 people formed the major, they were the core foundation of the European Union. Now, let's go to the Bible and see what the Bible said about this. Did the Bible talk about this? Revelation 13. Did the Bible talk about this? Let's see what Revelation 13 says. Somebody say, I'm ready. Say like, Roman, don't be scared. Somebody told me that you were scared after last Sunday's service. Roman, somebody say, I am ready.
Oh,
come on. If you are not scared, say, I am ready.
Say,
come, Lord Jesus. Say like you mean, say, come, Lord Jesus. Say it one more time, come, Lord Jesus. Are you ready for him, somebody? Somebody say, big
amen.
Revelation chapter 13, here you go. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise out of the sea, having 7 heads. And how many horns? I didn't hear you. How many horns? 10 horns. Major foundation. Have you know that these 10 horns are the 10 kingdoms that will establish Europe? He said, and upon these horns were 10 crowns. Now look at this mystery. Very important mystery. The beast had 7 heads. But where were the crowns? Oh, you are not reading your Bible. No. The beast has 7 heads. But where was the crown? On the horns. That's that scripture. You are following me. Why was the crowns not on the head? Because those heads did not represent the kingdom. Those heads represented the number of times this particular beast has been made manifest. They're talking about Rome. And you know it was the Roman Empire that established what we know today as Europe. Several times it has come up and come down. Several times it has come up and come down. So the 7th time it will come up, it will come up as the European Union. That's the 7 heads it's talking about. 7 times it reared its heads. That particular group. Now he says, if we have 10 horns, and upon those 10 horns are 10 crowns, talking about kingdoms, talking about in those days, they were not called, as countries, they were called nations or kingdoms. So he's trying to tell you that there will be 10 major nations that will form the European Union, and after that, other nations might join. But that particular area, where the 10 nations will come together to form an alliance. He said that particular area is where the beast will come from. The beast is the word, another word for the Antichrist. Somebody say big amen.
Amen.
Now he said, and the beast which I saw, verse 2, was like a leopard, and his feet as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him much power, that is Lucifer, and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his head as if it was wounded. So people will attempt to assassinate the Antichrist. And his deadly wound was healed. And all the earth wondered after the beast, like the Antichrist. And they worshipped him, verse 7. They worshipped the dragon, which gave unto the beast, which gave power to the beast. And they worshipped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? Verse 5. And there was given unto him a mouth, speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. Talking about 3.5 years. Amen. When you calculate the number of months. And he opened the mouth, his mouth in blasphemy against God to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle, and them that dwell in heaven. And look at this, verse 7. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints, and he overcame them. And power was given unto all him upon all the kingdoms, and kindreds, and tongues, and nations. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose names are not written. in the Lamb book of life. Verse number 9. Can we all read verse 9 together? Everybody want to go? Jesus will say, he that has ears, let him hear. He that has ears, do what? Let him hear. As I'm talking, he said, the days of my coming shall be like the days of Noah. Noah was shouting and shouting and shouting. They thought he was joking. Until, bam, it started happening. May the Lord help us in the name of Jesus. I'm talking about the timeline of the European Union. Now, this is very important. So, Greece joined in 1981, becoming the 10th member, most powerful member of the European Union. In 1993, the single market was completed. 1993. And everybody, now you have to do everything through the single market. On the 1st of January, 1999, the euro was adopted as one currency. Somebody say big amen. Which is the last thing that has been done in Europe. The European Parliament has been formed. The euro, one currency has been adopted. The only thing remaining is the election of the leader and the army. Once these two things happen, we are ready for one man to take over. But the army will come before the man is elected. And when he comes, it will become the most powerful nation, the most powerful. How many of you remember, how many of you were born when there was a nation called the USSR? What was the USSR? One of the USSR, and as at the time the USSR existed, America was not the superpower of the world. Are you aware of that? There were two superpowers, America and, you can't mention America without the USSR. Two of them were equal to each other. They couldn't fight each other because both of them had enough military power to destroy each other. Right now, America is called the superpower of the world because there is no contention, not even China. But when Europe rises, Europe will become the most powerful, more powerful than America. The whole world will look up to Europe. Because by then, the military power of America will have gone down a bit. So, Europe will be where everybody will now be looking up, just like everybody is looking up to America. Then, the man of sin will appear on the scene, ready for things to happen. Look at the neighbor and say, I won't be here. Say one more time, I won't be here. Somebody say big amen. So it's important that we get ready. I'm going to stop here for today. Next Sunday we'll continue. We're still on the end time. But somebody bless today.
Yes.
Now, so when you talk about signs of the end, you need to be ready. You need to understand that we're in the end times. You need to understand that Jesus is coming and he gave us warnings, he gave us signs. Unlike the people of Noah, Noah was just busy shouting, the flood is coming, the flood is coming, the flood is coming. There were no signs. Suddenly, there were fathers. But in our generation, you are blessed, you are lucky that there are signs. Jesus said, when you see these things happening, he said, the end is near. Be ready, get ready, because the end is near. So you cannot say you were thinking unawares. Because the signs are very clear. Everybody knows that it's already happening. Somebody say big amen. Prepare yourself, child of God. Don't allow anything to make you miss the second coming of Jesus. Don't allow anything to make you miss the rapture. Don't allow any quarrel with your husband make you miss the rapture. Don't allow any bitterness with your wife make you miss the rapture. Don't allow anybody's unforgiveness. Don't allow anybody make you have something that when the trumpet sounds, you won't be able to make. Whatever it is that the enemy wants to put in your heart, whatever sin that is stopping you, deal with it now. Wipe it out of your life. Tell yourself, I am a candidate of the rapture. I refuse to be left behind. It is so clear, child of God. Many of these things are being fulfilled by people that don't know the Bible, but they are fulfilling the Bible. It is only a wise man that sees the Bible and says, wow, these things have been written long ago, and now they are happening right before us. May God help us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
When Jesus appeared in the temple, the Bible said they gave him, the first time he went out, time gone 30 years. He went straight into the temple. When he went to the temple, he walked up to where the priest was standing. And when he walked up to where the priest was standing, the anointing was so much, the priest stepped aside. And he went and took the scroll. And he opened the scroll. Guess what he wrote? He read, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, the recovery of sight, to the blind." And he read and read and read. And the Bible said, listen, and he closed the scroll. And he said only one statement, and he walked away. He said, "Today, the scripture has been fulfilled in your very presence." He stepped aside, and he walked away. And the priest went back and continued with their job. That sentence changed the course of nature. I want you to understand that today, the scripture is being fulfilled in your very presence. What will you do about it? Will you continue your life as normal? Will you continue fighting and quarreling with everybody? Will you continue saying there are people you will never talk to in your life? They are devils and you will never ever... Will you continue to say there are people you will never forgive? These things will stop you from making heaven. Will you continue to live in that secret sin that nobody's aware, only you know? Only you know. Father, your heart is God. I want you to take up 1 minute and pray. Tell God what you want him to do in your life. Maybe there is something you want God to deal with in your life. It's only God that knows our hearts. Pastor does not know. Except God reveals your heart to me, I don't know. Only you know. Take that time and pray and say, "God, help me. I want to be a candidate of heaven. I want to make it. I cannot hear this kind of word and still miss the rapture. Help me, Lord. The time of your coming is near. It will happen any time from now. Child of God, without warning, as you are stepping out of here now, it will happen. In your house, it will happen. Don't allow anybody to deviate you from following Jesus. Don't allow any grudges, quarrel. Don't allow any fight, bitterness, unforgiveness to stop you. Don't allow your husband, your wife. You will give account of yourself when you get to heaven. You will be holding the hand of your wife to give you account when you get to heaven. Don't allow your brother. Your father offended you years back. You have not forgiven. It's time to forgive. It's time to forgive. Your mother offended you years ago. You've not forgiven. It's time to forgive. Somebody broke your heart some years back. Left you. Left the marriage. Left you completely empty. It's time to forgive and move forward. There is a sin you are struggling with. It's time to say, "I want to let go. I want to live like Christ. I want to live like a child of God. Enough of pretentious Christianity. Enough of pretending. Everybody knows me as a Christian, but in the secret I know I am living a life that is not acceptable to God." Next 1 minute, I want to pray for people as all heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. You are struggling with one area of your life. Maybe it's some of those things we've mentioned. Maybe it's forgiveness. There's somebody that has done something that you want to forgive. You want to say, "Lord, help me cleanse my heart." Maybe your Christian life, you are struggling with it. Maybe there's a secret sin that you are struggling with. All eyes bowed, all eyes closed, all head bowed. I just want to pray for you. If you're in that category, you want to say, "Pastor, help me, pray with me. I want to be strong in the Lord." Just lift up your right hand where you are, and I'm going to pray for you. Thank you. If there's somebody that you have not forgiven, mention their name. Say, "Lord, I forgive. Wipe away these hearts from my mind. wipe it away from my mind. If it's a secret sin, mention it. Say, Lord, help me to overcome this sin. Lord, help me to overcome this sin. Lord, help me. As your hands are raised, just pray that prayer. Between you and God, I don't want to know. I am not your God. God is there, sitting by you. I can see an angel sitting by you right now as we are talking, as we are praying. Maybe there is something you know, you have searched your heart, and you know that if the trumpet should sound out, you might not make it. And you are saying, Lord, help me. Mention it. If you are God, ask for revival in your heart, in your soul. Say, Lord, help me. Deliver me from this. Be bold enough to mention it. Say, Lord, help me with this. And I might be stronger. I might be a better Christian, Lord. I may know you, Father.
You are Yahweh. You are Yahweh.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
You are Yahweh.
Guy, his name is Abner, and I met him, and my had a frog compacted. So he's going to worship with us on the 1st of November. Luckily, the 1st day of November is Sunday. So we're going to have... Sorry? No, it's not a women conference. A women conference is
Sunday.
So the 1st Sunday is 1st. The women conference Saturday and Sunday. Yes, I'm aware. Amen. So that Sunday we'll have Minister Adnan ministering along with me. It's going to be a permanent service time. So invite people that we are building the temple and please have next Sunday is going to be very hot here. And God's going to glorify his name. So get ready. We are not here to frighten you. We are just here to present the fact as it is so that you can get ready for the coming of Jesus. Amen. Let's give our tithe and offering and we shall close.